Salva. I'm one of many program managers working to create great experiences for JavaScript and HTML applications using Visual Studio. This year, Microsoft made a huge investment in tooling these kinds of apps with new tools for CSS animations, page layout, custom fonts, data binding, all kinds of great stuff. In the next 20 minutes, I'm going to show you how to use these tools to create beautiful applications for the Windows Store. Let's get going. We're going to start in Visual Studio, where all of our coding happens. At this point, I've already created all the basic logic for the application. In fact, it goes out to Bing to get zip code and state information, and I also go out to the U.S. Census Bureau to get some demographic information. So let's see what this actually looks like as the running application. I'm just going to go here to run it in debug mode. Look at that. Here's our application, demographics. And demographics has got a bunch of different zip codes already created. If I click on one of these, I get to a detail page that gives me some of that Census Bureau information displayed as some pretty cool infographics. But there's a lot more work to be done here, so we're going to go to Blend to do that. I'm going to return back to Visual Studio, exit debug mode, and just right-click, open in Blend. Here I am, back in Blend. Now you'll see that I've actually got the running application right here in front of me. I'm going to go ahead and refresh it. There we go. Got the running application right in front of me, and on our design surface, we're actually running the full-fledged application. This application has JavaScript running, it's going out to the internet and pulling down images and making API calls. Our design surface is effectively exactly what you would get running in full screen mode. The only difference is that as I move around on the design surface and select objects, I'm able to inspect those objects and get information about where the object came from, what its properties are, what its attributes are. Over here on the left-hand side, we've got the project pane, similar to your Solution Explorer in Visual Studio. And down below it, perhaps more importantly, is the Live DOM. The Live DOM provides a view of, well, your document object model, all of the different elements and objects that are available in the page today. You'll notice here that many of these objects have different icons adjacent to them. For example, a cyan or kind of blue-colored lightning bolt indicates that that particular object was created by JavaScript. It doesn't actually exist in markup anymore or anywhere, and therefore it's pretty much impossible to edit its attributes through markup. We also have these others that have what looks kind of like a Rubik's Cube dissolving into nothingness. What that's saying is that this particular object comes from a fragment page. In fact, you can see here as I select one of these objects, I've got a little purple border around my design surface, and it tells me the selected content is part of groupedItems.html. So even though I'm within the context of default.html, I'm able to reach into the document and edit a completely different document from there. So on the right-hand side, as we select different objects, we've got our list of CSS properties. And the list of applied style rules, we see here kind of like the CSS cascade. And these are all the different style rules that apply to that particular element. You'll see as I select around to different elements, I get a sort of a deeper cascade and a look at all the other different style rules that apply to that. By selecting individual style rules, I can then go down and edit those specific style rules. Well, one of the first things we want to do here is kind of elevate the brand of this particular page. Right now it's just using Times New Roman for all the fonts, and that's not very modern at all. So let's do that. Let's add a custom font. I'm going to right click here and just add an existing item. What I'm going to add is a true type file, or actually an open type file. In this case, it's Museo Sans. And as soon as I import that guy, you'll notice that we get a dialog here asking if we want to add an at font face rule. Well, yes, absolutely we do. When we say OK, we are greeted with another dialog that provides a range of different options. And as you may know, the way most fonts work is there's a single file for each font weight. So there might be one for italics, another one for bold, another one for normal, another one for bold and italics. Well, in this particular case, I'm just going to use a single font font file for all of my fonts, so I'm not going to actually specify different font styles and font weights. I'll just say OK and use all the defaults. And as soon as I've done that, you'll see, bam, the design surface updates using all of the updated fonts. And now it's kind of looking a little bit more modern, a little bit more branded. Okay, from here, I actually want to get in and edit one of my interior pages. Now, as I said before, our design surface is actually running the full-fledged application. JavaScript is executing. This is really exactly what you would see in full screen, except constrained down to a nice design surface that allows us to select elements. But what I want to do here is I actually want to edit one of the interior pages. Well, if I didn't navigate to that interior page, I wouldn't have the data context to actually edit any of the objects kind of as they would appear in the running application. What I need to do is I need to navigate. Well, to do that, I'm going to invoke interactive mode. Interactive mode basically allows me to use all of my clicks as actual navigation, as I actually would do in the running application, navigate over to that new page, exit out of it, and then preserve the state so that I can continue about my editing. Now that I'm here on the item detail page, I notice that one of my graphs is missing. In this particular case, it's the population graph. And what I want to do is data bind my graph to the underlying model. In this case, I've got a percent count for each age segment for both males and females. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over here and actually use my Search the Live DOM to find that. I happen to know that those have a class of male. All right, look at that. We've just searched the Live DOM and filtered it down. All of the objects that match that male class now are highlighted in blue. I'm going to select one of those guys, and I've already searched for width here, and so I'm just going to data bind the width property to, here it is, male percent. This dialog provides a list of all the properties that are available to me within this particular data context. For each one of those properties, Blend is smart enough to tell me whether or not the property is a string, a number, an image, or an array or collection. We're going to go with male percentage, click OK, and look at that. It instantly replicated out to all of the items that are driven by that template, and they're all data bound to the male percent property. Well, I want to do the same thing for female, so I'm just going to change my search over here using the CSS syntax. I'm going to search for class of female. Those guys are highlighted, and I want to data bind it to female percent this time rather than male percent. Fantastic. All right, so now we've got a nice distribution, a nice histogram showing us all the males and females in there. All right. So now, you'll notice that in the background, we have kind of a Bing satellite image of this particular zip code. Let's actually zoom in a little bit so we can see that better. Yeah, there we go. So you see the satellite image in the background, and that's great, but I kind of want to add a little bit of extra pizzazz to that. You know, what I actually really want to do is I want to animate that background so we provide kind of like a zooming in effect. This is really popularized by a documentarian by the name of Ken Burns, and I love his documentary, so let's actually make that happen here. So in this case, I'm going to search for that satellite image first. Oh, there it is right there. And let's try to get, I'm going to hit Control 0 to zoom out again. Let's try to get some of these histograms and infographics out of the way just while we are animating here. So I'm going to open this guy up. Let's actually just use the design time toggle to hide some of those guys. Okay, that's better. Now I can actually see my satellite image behind it. Search for satellite again. Here we are. I'm going to select it, and let's animate this guy. To do this, I'm going to go to our animation category editor here, and I want all of those, all these style CSS property declarations to go in satellite. So I'm going to select satellite from my list of applied style rules, add in an animation. We'll do Ken Burns justice and call this our Ken Burns animation. We want this to occur over a relatively long period of time. I'll give it, let's start with, say, 4 seconds. I'm going to give it a delay of 0, iteration count of 1, that's the number of times the animation will actually play. Timing function, we've got a number of different options there. We're going to choose ease in and out. You might recognize these timing functions from really any animation library. Fill mode is what happens when the animation stops playing. Do you want it to preserve that last frame? In this case, yes, we do. So we want it to fill forwards into time. We want the animation to play in the normal direction as opposed to in reverse or alternating kind of in the ping pong manner. And then we want it to start running. Okay, now that I've defined my basic animation duration, delay, etc., let's actually get to the work of defining what the animation does, where it moves to. So I'm going to click Edit Animation, and voila, I've got a nice, recognizable animation timeline that I can work with here. It's already set to 4 seconds for me, and well, I can scrub, but scrubbing doesn't do much for me, so since I don't have any keyframes yet. So let's start by animating this guy. I want to start by setting the opacity to 0. Notice that I can do this. I've just searched for opacity, but if I know exactly what I want to set that opacity to, exactly what the CSS syntax is, I can just go ahead and type 0, enter, and it automatically sets the CSS property for me. Now I want that to fade in after about 1 second. So here, 1 second, I'm going to say opacity, let's set it to 0.4. Good. So now you'll see as I scrub over this, I'm fading in. All right, I've got the fade in, but I said I also want it to kind of pan and zoom here as well. So let's get to the end of our animation here, and we're going to add a little transform here. We're going to add a 2D transform. We're going to start by making it scale upwards. In this case, I want it to scale up by, let's say, about 1.2. So I'm in the x-axis and the y-axis, scaling it up by a factor of 120% or 1.2. And now you'll see as I scrub through it, I'm actually getting that zoom in. I also here want it to kind of pan a little bit, so I'm also going to add a translate. And we're going to translate this over, let's say by about 5%. And scroll down or translate down by about 2%. I can do this in pixels, I can do this in m's, I can do this in percentage, whatever works best for me. So now I see I've got both a pan and a zoom. Let's see what that actually looks like when I play it. That's pretty good, but you know what? That's actually a little bit fast for me. I want that to go a little bit slower. So I'm going to zoom out in my timeline here, and I'm just going to drag this timeline to expand it out to something closer to, let's go to like 8 seconds. How about that? We're going to reduce our fade in back to 1 second. Let's play it again. Beautiful. That's a little bit more subtle, a little bit more like what I was looking for. Fantastic. So now we'll go back over to our live DOM, restore the visibility, and let's see what that actually looks like if we were to play it. We're going to go into interactive mode to get a reproduction of it. And there you go. Animation, CSS, pure CSS animation with no JavaScript, all done through a timeline editor. While we're there, I also want to take a quick look at the code that this generated. Let's go on over to our CSS file and look here. Our keyframes are created with absolute pristine, almost poetic tabbing and code. And let's also take a look at, let's find our satellite image here. Look at this. duration appears not in the longhand, not separated out as animation duration, animation delay, etc., but it's actually compressed it down to the shorthand for that syntax. Great. All right, so now that we've gone through animation, I actually want to get back to my original page, to my home page here, exit out of that, and you know what, from here, I actually want to add in a button for my app bar. Now, our app bar already exists. If I go in interactive mode, if I right-click here, you can see it. It brings it right up there. I actually already have a button there for add zip code. And if I exit out of interactive mode, that app bar is preserved. I could also, if I wanted, I'm going to search here for app bar. Here it is. Just found it right there. I can also right-click on this guy and say activate app bar. Click that on and off, and it will toggle it without me having to enter into interactive mode to activate it. While I'm here, I want to add a button, so I'm going to go over to my Assets pane, search for App Bar. In this case, what I want to add is an App Bar command. There we go. Here's one right here. I've just added this guy in, and from here, if you'll notice, I'm going to zoom in here so we can see it. Over. All right, our button's been created, but it doesn't have a symbol in it yet. So we're going to go over to our Windows controls, and we've got a drop down here for icon that provides us with a bunch of different options. So I'm just going to choose one at random here. Let's choose the switch symbol. And we also want to provide an actual name telling what this button's going to do. What I'm going to use this button for is I'm going to use this to toggle into high contrast mode. Let's say that the satellite imagery makes it a little bit hard to see what's actually kind of going on in terms of text and legibility. So let's just call this high contrast. Okay, great. That's automatically updated my app bar with the correct symbol and called it high contrast. Here, I'm going to now add one of the new JavaScript behaviors, brand new to Visual Studio 2013. I'm going to add the toggle class behavior. So let's call this, here we are, the toggle class action. Great. All I have to do now that I've selected that button is double click toggle class. That adds the behavior to it. And you'll see over here in HTML attributes, I've got a new category called behaviors. In this particular case, what it's going to do is when I click that button, it's going to add a class. When I click the button again, it's going to remove the class. It will toggle the class on and off. The class name in this case that I want to add and remove is called High Contrast. And I have the option here to say where I want to, what object, what element I want to toggle that class on. In this case, I want to toggle that class on Content Host, my sort of most top level element. So, we're going to use CSS syntax here, and notice as soon as I hit hash or pound, I get a list of all the elements that are currently in my DOM that have an ID, and sure enough, Content Host is one of the first ones in there, it being in alphabetical order. So I'll just use that. Great. Now let's see if that actually works for me. I'm going to go back into interactive mode, say yes, I want to reload because I've just added some JavaScript to my page, and I want to make sure that executes. Here we are. I'll right-click to get my actual app bar commands. I will click my button, and there we go. It toggled the high contrast class, and I've already previously set all the colors and whatnot for that, and that gave me, kind of removed all the satellite imagery and gave me a high contrast view of my application. If I toggle it again, sure enough, it removes that class, and I've got all of my satellite imagery back. Beautiful. In the last few minutes, you learned how to brand your user interface with custom fonts, animate objects using CSS animations, data bind to your data source, and add interactivity with custom behaviors. If you'd like to try Blend, it comes with Visual Studio Express. I hope you'll give it a try and email me with your experiences, good or bad.